Yeah, thanks for that excellent summary. Feel slightly nervous being a bit of a movie star. If it comes out well on the final take. So I want to get to know you guys a little bit quickly before we launch in, but just a little bit about myself and what I'm going to do with the Bureau. I joined in 2002, so studied oceanography, meteorology, and joined the Bureau's graduate program in 2002, and they put you through a further training course as a forecasting meteorologist. So I did that and then spent 5 years doing short-term forecasting, so aviation, marine, severe weather, public weather forecasting, so looking out a week ahead, that sort of time frame. You learn a great deal on doing that, looking at trying to work out what the hell's going on. I'm very focused, very local scale. And then I moved into the longer term. I got interested in some of the things I'll be talking about today. So what drives and influences the weather patterns and the climate that we experience on the sort of seasonal timescale, looking out through months and seasons and even years ahead. And that moves across into the climate change space as well, so climate trends and changes, climate variability over decades. So I'll be touching on some of all of that today. So I guess there's quite a few things I wanted to get across. As you've heard, the Bureau's got a new supercomputer. We are constantly, we're a very technical organisation. We're constantly improving and upgrading our information. One of the things I really love about the job is it's really about bringing a great deal of technical expertise and power and bringing that down to help save lives, help reduce the impacts of extreme events, and help improve the productivity of people like yourselves who are out there, you know, engaging in whatever activities you're doing. So that's, you know, it gives a great deal of satisfaction, I've got to say. And there's a lot of improvements that are constantly happening, improving resolution of computers, satellite imagery, all sorts of weather modelling and different timescales. And we are constantly improving and upgrading what we're doing. And so there's a lot of newer stuff that you may or may not have heard of that is very much, I'll be going through today, so just getting a sense of what information you can go to across various timescales. I'm really happy to keep it interactive, so if you've got questions as we go through, really happy to take those. But
Yeah,
if you can turn that one on and just get a browser up, that'd be great. So what I might do is, I've got the presentation, but I might hop across as we go through to some of our products on the webpage, so we can actually look at stuff in, look at some of the stuff that's on our website. So I understand we've got people largely in livestock, so dairy. So who's in dairy? So I've already spoken to one or two people who are other people running livestock. Okay, so that's probably, yeah, a lot of people. We've got people in grape growing grapes. No, anyone grape growing? Okay, Mark mentioned there might be someone from.
I've got one grape vine and one.
Okay. And Mark mentioned there might be someone who's in the fishing industry. So okay, we've got anyone else? Have I missed anyone? Okay, that's good. That just gives me a sense. So there's no one cropping grain, I'm assuming, down who's come along. So what's going on there? So I might just get out the Bureau's website. So you can just do a, so that's easy as that, just do a search BOM, Bureau of Meteorology, and that's the website, so we'll start off there. So I guess I'm going to go through, start off with what information we've got about what's been happening or what's happening at the moment. So before I get on to the weather forecasting space the week ahead, and then get on to the longer term climate influences and the season outlook information, and then I'll touch on some longer term trends and changes at the end. Okay, yep. No worries. Back over to here. Beautiful, okay. So we have stations, we have thousands of stations around the country, we've got hundreds of automatic weather stations, and we've been taking observations. We have, you know, Bureau has been in existence for over 100 years, and we came into being from a number of state-based agencies, colonial agencies that have been taking weather observations back for a long time, and we'll be seeing some of that. But if you're wanting to look at all of our daily, monthly rainfall and temperature data, it's freely available through this Climate Data Online tool. So if you go onto the climate and past weather link on this, just go into there, and you can go into that and this weather and climate data will take you onto this Climate Data Online page. So just into there. So all Bureau daily and monthly rainfall and temperature data is just freely available. We also have water information available as well. So there's also a water page on there. Where's the browse back button on that one? So we also have a lot of water information on our water information page as well. So we also have a water data online tool as well. So if you're wanting river height data, stream flow data, that sort of thing, you can go and get that from that. There's an equivalent water data online service on that water information page. We take all of our rainfall temperature data. We run an interpolation scheme, so we join the dots onto a grid, 5-kilometre grid across all of Australia, to produce maps of things like rainfall, temperature. We've also got a humidity. We also run solar radiation, so we have a satellite-derived solar radiation scheme. We've also got satellite-derived normalised difference vegetation index, NDVI, which is a satellite measure of vegetation growth on there as well. I'll touch on that one a bit more. So you can actually look at, we've run these maps retrospectively, so you can actually look at maps of rainfall and temperature and these other parameters. Satellite ones only back maybe 20, 30 years, but the rainfall temperature back to around about 1900 or 1910 for temperature. So you can actually look at what's been happening either directly for station data or at the map scale as well. You can put them into a GIS system if you're into that sort of thing. There's also other tools like Climate is worth a look as another tool which is actually pulls in the Bureau data into various tools that help people utilise the information and make decisions off that sort of data. Now I will give the presentation to Mark as a PDF afterwards, so don't get too caught up about having to scribble down web links as we go through, because we'll make that available. So one of the newer things we've been doing as well is so there's the vegetation mapping. So just to show you what sort of information that might give sense of what's happening, that might give you. That's the difference from average of vegetation growth from the satellite data at the end of, in August last year, and that's just comparing it to August this year. So you can see a very different picture is emerging in terms of the conditions that we're seeing. So once again, it's a lot of our products tend to be a little bit broad scale. So they're good for seeing what's happening on bigger areas. So we are a national organisation, so we tend to look across that sort of national picture. But you can drill down to at least the state scale with these maps. One of the newest things we've been doing is all of that gridded data that we create from the station data, we put that into a water balance modelling system. So it's a model that has two layers of soil, three layers in this particular model, through the soil profile, models three layers in the soil. calculates the things like evapotranspiration and moisture fluxes and heat fluxes, and calculates the rainfall and the runoff, various parameters, and so calculates how much things like soil moisture levels. So you've got things like runoff, rainfall runoff, evapotranspiration, soil moisture levels at different layers in the soil profile. It's been run retrospectively as well. It's on a 5 kilometre grid, and we've just made this tool available on once again on our water information page to go into there and look for this water balance landscape modelling system. And so if you can look at the difference from average or actual values. So, and you can look back by daily or monthly or yearly values. So,
what's the green? The scale on it on the map on the right? It goes from what I think it's 5, is it?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
So the dark green is 5, what's that in correlation to? Is that just the vegetation?
So I've got the difference from average here. So to be honest, I'm actually not sure what those units are off the top of my head. I couldn't tell you off the top of my head what they're using for that. It'll have it in the, it'll have on the web page if you go in and look at the climate pass weather maps. It'll have the information about that, but I'll just duck into this one first. So we're talking about going into this landscape water balance. And there's an about button up there, which tells you what it is. So that's probably the best picture there. It's got three different layers that it models, and so it brings in each day. It updates with the latest daily values. So it brings in the latest rainfall, temperature, solar radiation. Data and just calculates, how much is runoff, how much is evaporated or transpired, how much has moved into the various layers in the soil model. So you can look at, so this is looking at this time last year, and we're seeing quite dry conditions, very much below average soil moisture levels in the top 1 metre layer of the model across much of Queensland, I'll say Tasmania, but also particularly Victoria and across to this part of the world. And then we contrast that with what we're seeing at the moment. So those red areas are below average, and we're seeing a very different picture at this time at the moment. So you can actually click on, if we get rid of, let's zoom in, and you can just click on the map, click upon a point on the map. We'll give you a time series of things like the various values that, or whatever parameter you're interested in there. So you can download those into a CSV, so pop it into a spreadsheet and play around with it. You can get back about 10 years worth just out of this tool. So. So we only put this on the website about, it's actually almost getting on to about a year now, it's November last year. So we're actually just interested to see what sort of use people might make of this, and how, obviously it's modelled, so there are going to be differences between, if you've got soil moisture probes, that they're going to differ from this. For a whole number of reasons, because you're talking about differences on scale, and this is modelled rather than directly observed. It does get calibrated with observations of soil moisture, feed into it and calibrate it. So, it does get some real world data put into it. So just something that's we're just interested to see how people might make use of that. Just as a bit of backdrop. This is a map of rainfall. It's from January 2014 to the end of last year, and you can see it was very dry across in these red areas across. We've got Western Queensland, southwestern WA, but this part of the world, and actually heading down to the southeast and Western Tasmania generally, has been very dry a couple of years. So you know, there's been some tough conditions that you guys have had to deal with over the last through that period. This year's presenting a bit of a different picture, so I'll tease out what's influencing that and what we're seeing happening at the moment. And so we're seeing actually a pretty strong shift in the other direction. So I'll talk about, once I get past the week ahead scale, we'll talk about what's going on underlying those conditions. So just for those who, I mean, there's probably a lot of you in the room here probably pretty familiar with this sort of stuff, but I thought I might just cover it quickly in terms of understanding weather charts. So this is a typical weather chart like you might, as you might see in the paper or on our website. We've got, it's a map that joins lines between locations that have the same surface air pressure. So so we take observations, we have ships and station observations, we have buoys that float around, thousands of buoys that float around the world taking air pressure readings as well, feeding into this sort of analysis. And so, and we do still hand draw the maps back in the office in the forecasting centre, because it is actually a useful process. So we've got lines of equal air pressure, so big high pressure system sitting here. We can see this ridge of high pressure through running across Australia. So that's called the subtropical ridge, and it's basically if you can draw that line right around the whole southern hemisphere, joining this sort of line of high pressure. I'll talk about that a bit later on. We've got this cold frontal system back up here, so the barbs denote a change in air temperature between warmer air here and colder air mass that's sitting back behind the cold front. And the trough around the cold fronts with the change in air temperature, you see a shift in wind direction. So also with the change in temperature, you see a shift in wind direction. Troughs in the dashed line are just a weaker version, in essence, of the cold front. You tend to see more of just a shift in wind direction and less of a change in air temperature with those. So we've got cold fronts. So we've got defining the line between warmer air and cooler air. Troughs, you see a bit of a shift in wind direction. The winds in the southern hemisphere go clockwise around the low, so they tend to go all cold frontal systems. So they're coming clockwise around, so they're coming from the west here, they go anti-clockwise around high pressure systems. So they're coming around this way around the high, coming this way around the high. So you can see we've got northerlies here, then we've got the wind shift, winds coming more from the west to southwest as that trough in the cold frontal system moves through. The closer the bars, the stronger the winds. So so you can get a sense of the wind direction, wind speed, and also changes in air temperature. So in terms of looking at weather forecasting information, it's important to keep in mind that there's a whole range of agencies and the Bureau run a whole range of weather forecast models that run out about a week ahead, up to about a week ahead. Some of them go a bit longer, they can rerun 10, 12 days ahead or even a bit longer than that. So they're complex computer programs. They forecast these days down to about the 5 kilometre scale. Some models can go a little bit higher resolution than that. The calculations have errors in them. So each time you do a new time step, so you advance another, say, 3 hours ahead, there's a little bit of error that creeps into the weather model forecast each time you go forward a time step. And what you want to do is minimise that error as much as you can. And that the more you can minimise the error from the starting point and as you step through, the more accurate and the further ahead you can actually run the model and get accurate forecasts. But inevitably, those errors will build up over time, and that's what limits the forecast accuracy. Now the other thing is the various different weather models that get run, they have slightly different calculations or systems that they're running. So the Europeans run their own weather models, and we look at those, and we share them all, and we all look at each of the different weather models. But they all do differ slightly. And we can see things happening like the, this is the European Centre model that we look at, and they share with us. We share ours with their, with them. We do see interesting things like we were noticing anomalous moisture coming off the centre of South Australia, and that would generate some localised thunderstorm activity. And what we actually found out digging in and talking to them is that they actually had painted Lake Eyre and all the various lakes up in the north. They were called lakes in the atlas, so they actually painted water in them all the time, which is obviously not the case in reality. So you get things like that you've got to be a little bit careful of. The models differ a little bit, the errors creep in. We use the satellite data there's thousands and thousands of satellite points that come in, measurements down through the atmosphere, all the surface data. We try to get as best a most accurate starting point as we can. So the more data we can have to feed into the forecast system to make it as accurate, the most accurate starting point we can, the better the forecast will be. And the higher the resolution, that gives us a more accurate picture as well. So we can actually use the supercomputer to run, the power of the supercomputer to run out in shorter time steps and run out further ahead in higher resolution. But I guess where I'm getting at is there's a whole lot of different weather model data that's floating around the space, and some of that's made freely available. So there's a US model called the GFS, for instance, which a US agency runs, and they just make that freely available to anyone who wants to grab it off the website. Now that's one model, and what we've found is if you incorporate a whole range of weather model information into your forecast, that gives you a much better forecast looking out further ahead. And that's the way we do things. So I guess one of the points is when you're looking at stuff, particularly on apps on your mobile phone, that may well be using just one of these weather models that's freely available. And that may give you an okay picture, but may not necessarily be the best forecast information that you can get hold of. So just looking at, stepping out, this is forecast over the next few days. We're just seeing a bit of it's a bit of a weak change that's coming through at the moment. We're seeing something else, another low pressure system building up back here, and that's starting to build up a little bit as we go through tomorrow, and then turns into a quite intense low pressure system as we go through Wednesday and into Thursday. So we've been seeing a lot of these over the last few months, and we saw that event earlier in September. So in the short term, we are seeing some pretty significant indications of fairly intense rainfall through the next few days. And there is, looking even further ahead, there's looking like a fairly similar event building up around the middle of next week as well, sort of early to mid next week. So it's wet out there, as you've seen from those water balance modelling systems, and we've got a couple more systems coming through in the short term that you want to keep an eye out for. You can see in this there's a little bit of a hint of a feed coming down from the northwest, and I'll talk about that a bit more in terms of the background influences that we're seeing. So we updated our forecasting systems quite dramatically about four or five years ago now, actually. This next generation forecasting system, and what that does is it takes in all the various weather models, so our models, and we run a few different ones, takes in the European, Japanese, a couple of US ones, whole range of weather models, weights them according to how well they've been performing over the last 30 days. That interpolates that onto a 6-kilometre grid across Australia, and then the forecasters run various calculations and algorithms across the top of that to account for things like sea breezes and things like that. Because the weather models are still, some, a lot of them are still a little bit too coarse to do things like sea breezes properly. Some of the finer scale stuff doesn't get done so well, so we actually run calculations to account for that. And we do this twice a day, so when all the new weather model runs come through, it gets updated twice a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon. And when the forecasts are all happy with what they're seeing represented, they press a button and it all just goes out to all our products on the web. So there's a lot less of the typing that I used to do when I was doing forecasting. But there is a fair bit of time spent running various tools across the weather grids. And so there is a thing called the Australian Digital Forecast Database, which is which is our forecast database, which we maintain with this model input. It's constantly maintained, has all the different parameters across 6 kilometres across all of Australia. Now the main way people can access the weather forecast information is through this thing called METI. So how many people here have been in and looked at METI?
I wouldn't
know. Yeah, excellent. That's like that. So so if you haven't, there's one thing you take away from today, go and have a look at METI. And the way to access that, most particularly on your smartphone, you can actually go to this m.bomb.gov.au thing on your smartphone on a browser. It's not an app, it's a mobile-friendly web version of the website. And so if you take nothing else from today, I mean, feel free, pull out your mobile phone now, pop this into a browser on your website. So if you take nothing else, go and have a look at that on a browser on your smartphone.
Darren, on the 6 kilometre grid, is there a fixed map, as it were, or is there a map which shows where the grid lines are?
Let's go and have a look. Okay, so
this is sitting within a computer program, so
yeah. I might actually grab this, or maybe even that one might be better. Thank you. All right, so let's go into METI. Obviously, you've been on there before, otherwise it would ask the disclaimer. So it's map enabled, so you can actually just you zoom in, move around. You can put in your location, so it's come up with Victor Harbour in there, so we'll just select that, and it just pulls up the week ahead forecast. So you see on there we've got the radar, selected on there, and we've got forecast winds. Wind speed and direction on there as well. So there's a whole lot of parameters down the left-hand side. So when you put in your location, well, you can just click on the map. So you can click on the map and it'll give you a latitude and longitude. That's Baker. Or you can actually pop in a latitude and longitude as well. So there's and it is also run off the ocean, off the coast as well, so you can get the forecast. So if you're out, if you're wanting to head off somewhere out, and you know, it does extend out into the coast as well, so you can actually head out and click and get a sense of what the winds are going to be doing. You can click on each, so on the detail button, you can click and see what you're expecting through the day. So we've got the winds, 3-hour time steps through the day, or the likelihood of rainfall, temperatures, so there's your wave heights as well. But for back on the land, click on your detail, and you've got your likelihood of rainfall in there as well. And you click on the text view is actually a good thing to do as well. So that you can actually go down and once again shows your possible rainfall in 3-hour time steps, likelihood of rain. So on those text views or those detailed views, you can actually gives you a look at the likelihood of rain. So you've got likely rain amounts up there. So there's different your chance of getting different amounts of rainfall. So and your air temperatures, your likelihood of thunderstorm, frost, fog, and then your wind speeds as well. So we're getting really good feedback about the winds. So from boaties, but also from farmers spraying as well. They're finding this, you can actually look at up to about a week ahead and pick your windows in which you might be able to get some spraying done using this, and we're getting some really good feedback about that. So yeah, you can use this sort of information, see when's the rain going to come. So you can actually see here, okay, we've got a bit of shower activity around this morning. It's looking very much like it'll clear off, and there's much less going to be around through the afternoon. And looking at the wind speeds, so you can actually look at your winds and see, okay, how windy is it going to be? Am I going to get some wind going? We've got the mixing height in there as well, which is a bit of an indication of the strength of inversions forming as well. So yeah, rain through the morning, not much around in the afternoon, and air temperatures, yeah, it's all pretty cold. We've got the UV index in there. Winds, yeah, west to southwesterly, so, and yeah, fairly fresh, but easing into the evening. So yeah, you can dig into the information reasonably well. So yeah, if you're wanting to ask questions like, I guess you can look at the data for a particular point, or you could also do things like, okay, you want to look at the rainfall. So for each day we've got a map that shows the percent likelihood of any rain. So we're talking 0.2 millimetres or more in the day. So it's pretty likely that there'll be some sort of rainfall, okay? In terms of your rainfall amounts, you can actually go and see, okay, there's a 50% chance of getting, and it's only in the order of, we're only talking 0 to 1 millimetres, so there's a 50% chance of getting a millimetre or so.
Yep. Wednesday coming.
Yep.
Or might
longer. Okay, so we'll go back to the chance of rain again. Okay, so yeah, it's going to rain.
what time's it going to rain?
Yep. Okay.
What's
so. All right, so how much are you going to get? Let's have a look. Okay, so we're talking 5 to 10. Pretty good chance of getting 5 to 10. There is a 25% chance, so it's not an insignificant chance of getting quite a bit more than that, so more than 15 to 25. Could even be 25 to 50, so... Well, the model gives a distribution. So we're talking about a low pressure system, okay? We're talking about a fairly tight low pressure system. That low could move just a degree or two further south, the centre of that, and that would significantly reduce the amount of rainfall that you guys might experience here, or particularly areas up in the areas of Adelaide itself would experience. It might mean that Gamrobe, Mount Gambier, the lows further south, they might get a lot more rainfall there. So in this type of particular weather system, you know, it doesn't take a whole lot for a very different outcome to occur.
Getting heads up on the scale of the event.
Yeah, so this gives you a range of outcomes. It gives you, okay, it's we're going to see some rainfall, we're going to get some reasonable, at least 5 to 10 millimetres out of it. There's a pretty reasonable chance it could get a fair bit wetter than that. That's what I'm taking from this. So I mean, if you're a cropping farmer looking to put out some urea, you'd be going, yeah, okay, I'm going to spend 10-15 grand and put out some urea with this. Whereas the event, rainfall today is a lot more marginal, and you'd be going, no, there's no way I'm going to spend that sort of money. You guys might make different decisions, but we're looking at this, you'd be going, okay, it's going to be a pretty wet day, and it could get really wet, so I might have to do some stuff around that. Winds are going to rain through the day, so you can go and do 3-hour time steps. So you click on those and it opens up. They were probably, we're just a little bit too far ahead for all of those 3-hour time steps to come in. So if you look in the next run from this afternoon, it'll paint those 3-hour time steps in there. So you can actually see as you go through when the rain's going to be coming. So yeah, it's good to use the point stuff, so for what it says for your particular location. I think it's also useful to look at the maps as well, because you actually get a sense of, okay, it's painting some wet conditions not very far from me. You know, that means I might actually just keep that in mind, that we're talking about some, all it would take is that low pressure system to be a little bit further south, and we might see some of this down here. So this is where, these type of low pressure systems, they're the things that give us some headaches, because it doesn't take a lot for very different outcomes to happen for a particular location if that low is a little bit further north or a little bit further south. So, okay. It is. We do maintain a backup. Buckland is our main radar for Adelaide, for the Adelaide region, and most, a fair bit of southern South Australia. It's a Doppler radar, where the Selix one's not. So we actually get quite a bit more information out of the Buckland Park radar. It's actually the Buckland Park radar is getting a major upgrade around about April, May next year. It could end up being in later in the year. But that's actually will improve the capability again of the Buckland Park radar, but we'll actually have to come offline for 4 to 6 weeks for that to happen. So we've got problems with Selix because we've got trees going up around it which actually impact the radar signal. We've been doing some work to reduce the impact of that. It is very much more a backup.
Are you cutting the trees down there?
We did cut some trees down just recently. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So how does Buckland Park get across the hill?
It's a reasonable point. On the eastern side of the hills, certain situations that won't see the low level moisture as well as it would do on the other side of the hills. So it's not perfect. Selix has got some issues. We're trying to reduce those. So just to keep moving. Okay, so go and have a look at this, because it's pretty beaut. I won't do it now, but if you go on to, I did this over the weekend, popped in Victor Harbour. So you pop this in your browser, you get this page, looks like that, and you click on the little thing up there and you probably put in your location, or you can use the GPS on the smartphone if you want to do that to find the grid point where you are. And it'll load that up, and it's got the current forecast conditions, and that also finds the closest automatic weather station. So for this instance, it goes to Hindmarsh Island. And it's got the forecast conditions out through the day ahead. If you go scroll down the page and go to this launch full site thing, you can actually get into that page, which gives you the 3-hour time steps. It's It's got the radar on there as well, and there is a into the outlooks about what the models are telling us about what's going to happen. So we've actually run seasonal outlook models which run out 9 to 12 months ahead that actually forecast the changes in the oceans that we see. We, we had this tracking system as well that it's got a dial thing on there and it just tells you where we're at the moment. So at the, last year we were in back in sort of March, April, we went into watch and alert status for El Nino, and then we declared an El Nino event starting up in May last year. And all last year we were in El Nino territory. And then we went back into neutral territory back in May this year. And then shortly after that we went into a watch phase for La Nina. So we're actually watching, keeping an eye on the possibility of a La Nina event developing this year. Now you can actually look at the history of all this, so you can look at the criteria that we use. You can look that define what state we're in. You can look at the history. So there's a fair bit of stuff on there on this, what El Nino is about. Now, Southern Oscillation Index, is anybody familiar with the, heard of that one? Okay. So they talk about it on landline. If you're a regular landline watcher, they tend to talk about the SOI or Southern Oscillation Index. Now what that is, it's basically a measure of what's going on with this atmospheric circulation pattern, the Walker circulation. So the SOI is a calculation that's done from the difference from average of the surface air pressure at Tahiti out in the middle of the Pacific from the difference from average of the surface air pressure at Darwin. And so when the air is sinking down more at Darwin and there's higher than average surface pressure, and you have lower than average surface air pressure in Tahiti because the air is rising up, that calculation results in negative SOI values. So when you see prolonged negative SOI values, it's telling you that the Walker circulation's broken down and you've probably got an El Nino event around. So it was the original monitoring way that the El Nino La Nina thing was monitored, because we've got air pressure readings back to 1870s. So we can actually calculate the SOI back to the 1870s. Whereas we've got satellite data we monitor now, we've only got obviously 30 or 40 years of that. And then the opposite, when you have the air rising up more over Darwin, you're getting lower than average surface air pressure and you're getting higher than average surface air pressure at Tahiti because the air's sinking down more. That results in positive calculations of the SOI, and that's telling you that there's a stronger Walker circulation, there's probably a La Nina event around the place. So if we see a few months of this positive SOI values, that's telling us there's probably a La Nina around, or we're seeing signs of the atmospheric response moving towards La Nina territory. Last year we saw quite strong from May through to May this year, we saw quite strong. It does spike around a little bit. Generally quite strongly negative SOI values indicating El Nino, and we went back to neutral, and we actually just spiked back up a little bit in the last week or so, into starting to head into something that's looking a bit, possibly a little bit La Nina-ish. But we want to see 3 or 4 months of this to actually be confident we're seeing signs of the of a La Nina event developing.
Right, Indian Ocean Oscillator.
Yep.
Is that another long-term weather pattern? Yeah. Off the west coast?
You're about a slide or two ahead of me.
Oh. So
now last year we had the El Nino event around. So this is last few months of last year. We had very hot and dry conditions. That was basically El Nino event. But we also had the Indian Ocean dipole leapt into the action as well. So. This is the Indian Ocean influence that you were just touching on there. So it's a similar pattern, the variability, sort of similar to the El Nino La Nina cycle, but in the northern Indian Ocean. And from 1 year to the next, you might see it be in neutral conditions, or it might, as it did last year, go into the positive phase, and that's where we see cooling off to the northwest in the oceans, gets warmer out near Africa. That increases the strength of the circulation and we get more air sinking down over Australia. So we get less moisture from the cooler oceans, we get the air sinking down once again, inhibiting rainfall, so we get less cloud, hotter and drier conditions. and you put the two together, El Nino and positive values of the Indian Ocean Dipole, and that's the very worst combination for hot and dry conditions in spring. And that's exactly what we saw develop last year. So, you know, you see El Nino and you go, okay, it's going to be hot and dry. You see El Nino and positive Indian Ocean Dipole and you want to be going, okay, it's going to be hot, very hot and dry. I'm probably going to have issues with feed and, you know, water availability and bushfires and heat waves and all that sort of stuff, which is what we saw last year. And you can see the opposite phase, negative values of the Indian Ocean Dipole. So the values of it, the names, the negative is coming from the calculations of the differences in the ocean temperatures. So negative values, we're talking negative values of the Indian Ocean Dipole, or the negative phase. You see warmer water off to the northwest, and we've had that through the last few months. Cooler water near Africa, increasing cloud and moisture availability, and we tend to get wetter and cooler conditions. And that's what we've been seeing this year. We actually went into the negative Indian Ocean Dipole back in sort of May, June, actually May, and that's why things have switched around quite dramatically. So we've gone from the worst combination for hot and dry conditions last year, so the positive IOD and the very strong El Nino event, and we've switched around to the negative Indian Ocean Dipole, a very strong one, and we're seeing some indications. It hasn't gone into La Nina yet, but it's hovering around the thresholds at the moment, starting to get a little bit La Nina-ish as well. And so the La Nina and the negative Indian Ocean Dipole together are the combination that's most conducive to wet, cool conditions. So you can look back to late 2010, early 2011, was probably the last time we had the two together. It's a very strong La Nina, and we also had negative Indian Ocean Dipole as well. Yeah. So these probably a little bit hard to see here, but these little squares here actually diagrams illustrating the changes down through the exactly. So yeah, the warmer water pushes the thermocline down. So we do see changes down deeper in the oceans. We've got ocean buoys out there telling us what's going on down to 300-400 meters depth, telling us what's happening with those as well. So we've had a real switch. We've gone from those very hot, dry conditions. It was a little bit wetter in some areas in the first few months of the year, but it's just gotten really wet. So this is incorporating, it's a preliminary analysis, but it's incorporating the September rainfall from May through to September. And we're seeing record rainfall across some areas. It's just been very wet. We've had record warmest ocean temperatures off to the northwest, feeding that moisture down as part of this negative Indian Ocean Dipole. The negative Indian Ocean Dipole has really been about the picture so far, about what's been happening through the last few months. These graphs may be interesting and useful. They're probably aimed a little bit more at the cropping farming community, but they're accumulated rainfall graphs showing April to October rainfall each year. The black line is the median accumulated through the year. We've got the decile 1 in the red, decile 9 in the green, and then the light blue line is what happened last year, and the red blue line is what's happening this year so far. So this is for Finnis. You can go onto that and have a look at those. It's a bit of a trial thing we did for PIRSA a few years ago. Basically last year it was actually running a pretty wet start to the year. Rainfall went below average, but actually wasn't running too badly until August, September, when the positive IOD kicked in on top of the El Niño, and rainfall's just switched off. This year we're seeing quite a different story in terms of the rainfall has been pretty similar to what it was last year, but actually it's just kept on going and going and going with that negative Indian Ocean Dipole influence. So I've seen some very wet events, particularly that sort of mid-September event. We've got more coming in the next week or so. So we're going to end up with a pretty wet conditions, getting up into the top 10% of September rainfall. So similar story for Victor Harbour itself. So you know, been that rainfall event dumped a lot of rainfall down here. So yeah, we've just a map of sea surface temperatures, very warm El Nino. This is December last year. Very warm El Nino signal. It was actually warm out. By the time we got to December, it actually was quite warm out in the Indian Ocean quite generally. And we're seeing quite a different story. We've got this negative Indian Ocean dipole signal here, and this sort of weak cooling in the Central Pacific. So, but yeah, record ocean temperatures out to the northwest at the moment. So, typical La Nina. We can still go into La Nina. It'll be a weak late one, but that could actually add on top of the negative Indian Ocean dipole influence. And the influence for La Nina does extend into summer a bit, so we're sort of watching the possibility of La Nina. It's showing some signs that actually could launch off into a weak one in the next couple of weeks. But there's been a bit of a burst of winds along the equator. If that does couple into the oceans, it could kick off into a week late La Nina event. That could contribute to some wet conditions later in spring and through into summer. So still watching that pretty closely. It does result in cooler conditions. So there tends to be cooler or warmer nights out in the east, cooler days. Indian Ocean Dipole, negative Indian Ocean Dipole, you tend to see cooler days particularly. There's a bit of a weak signal for cooler nights as well, a bit of a mixed story in terms of nighttime temperatures. Rainfall, you tend to get quite wet in winter, spring for the negative Indian Ocean Dipole, and that's exactly what we're seeing at the moment. So it's all pretty typical negative IOD sort of stuff. The IOD starts off around about sort of May, June, July, and it runs until the start of the Asian monsoon, kicks off in usually mid-November, mid-late November, and that kills it off. So it's got a tighter window. It's more of a sort of June to October influence with peak influence in August, September, October. So we're right at the time peak influence of this negative ID right at the moment, September, October, and then it gets killed off as it goes through November. So expecting this influence to wind up as we go in towards the end of the year.
And the question... Does that mean, May, that the increased rainfall we're getting now, yep, is moisture being pulled in from the equator?
From off around Northern Australia, yeah. Yep. And you do see changes in the weather patterns with these different types of influences. So in the negative Indian Ocean Dipole, the subtropical ridge tends to sit just a little bit further north, and you tend to get more cut-off lows happening. There's more and more low pressure systems coming through that can drag down moisture, exactly like what we're seeing right at the moment, the next week or so. We're seeing lots and lots of low-pressure systems. We had our windiest July on record for lots of areas in southern South Australia. So not good conditions to be trying to be getting out in the boat. Yeah, I'm sure you noticed that. Now we run Caesar Outlook modelling systems, so we can actually run forecasts out months ahead. You can look at these on our website, so you can go back to the Outlook. How we go for time, Mark? We
10 to 11, so.
Okay, that's good. I've probably got about 10 minutes, so you can go into the Indian Ocean, and this is a forecast of the temperatures out of the Indian Ocean dipole values. So it's expected to go back to neutral. As little summary outlooks. So we've got these, they're all in negative territory, so we've got positive over here, that's where it was last year, neutral, and we've got negative. It's in negative territory at the moment, expected to stay there through October. These are various models, so we've got the bureaus, the East European, French, there's a couple of the US one, and then the UK. And then they're all going back to neutral as you'd expect, and it's the Indian Ocean Dipole is not an influence in by the time you get through into summer itself. So yeah, this is the way we run our own seasonal modelling system. We also share and look at other international modelling as well. I'll mention the Southern Annular Mode quickly. It's a mode of variability in the weather patterns that impacts Southern Australia. And so that's just a model showing the cold frontal systems embedded in the westerly airstream whizzing around Antarctica. It happens constantly. And so this westerly airstream that whizzes around, sometimes it can be a bit more contracted or sometimes a bit more relaxed. And when it's a bit more relaxed, we get the cold frontal systems can move up further north over Southern Australia. When it's a bit more constricted, everything's a bit tighter and whizzing around a bit more closely around Antarctica, and the cold fronts tend to sit a bit further south. So there's a measure of this called the Southern Annular Mode, and we actually look at that on our website. If anyone's looked at the Victorian DPI climate dogs, is that ringing any bells with anyone? The Victorian DPI have got this nice website where they basically call these different climate influences. They've got this cartoon thing that they've given them farmers' dogs names. So they've got Indy and Ridgy and Sam and they have this sort of nice animations that won these science awards, illustrate how these things work quite nicely. So we can actually look at what's going on with Southern Annular Mode values, and it's been popping all over the place through the last few months. We've had very strong Southern Annular Mode, positive in September, negative through August. So we actually monitor these modes of variability in weather patterns. There is a degree of predictability in this, but it really limited to about the two to four week time frame. So there's things like the strength of the subtropical ridge that we monitor, Southern Annular Mode, there's various other things that we look at.
How long does it take to go around the Antarctic?
Excellent question. It takes a few days, so perhaps a week to go across Australia. So you're talking quite a few weeks, several months to make its way, something like that, yeah. Yeah.
Well, as you read, the high pressure systems are highly stable, and it's the low pressure systems that are moving relatively quickly.
Yes.
So
yep.
What's doing the restricting of the low pressure systems? Is it actually the Hadley cell setup, or is it something more complicated than that?
It's a lot more complicated than that. You can see the subtropical ridge, the belt of high pressure around the mid latitudes there. In that map, there's interconnections between the tropics and this belt of high pressure. So you can get bursts of like a burst of wind in one particular location. They'll send a pulse down through the atmosphere that will influence the strength of where the high pressure systems are sitting. So there's linkages in between what's going on in the tropics and the mid latitudes that complicate things. And yes. Yep.
And this
influences the amount of sea ice as well, so that goes both ways.
Right.
So yeah. So the more tightly contracted this is, the stronger the westerly winds are, and sea ice tends to drift to the left of the winds. So when there's stronger westerlies, sea ice tends to drift more to the left and expand a bit more around Antarctica.
So do you have it's really intense down there.
There's thousands of floating buoys that are just deployed. They send ships out to drop buoys on a continual basis that just float around us. There's hundreds of them out there. I'm just conscious of time. So our seasonal outlook, which is on our climate and past weather page. So you can look at the short-term stuff on MedEye and the m.bomb.gov.au thing. Am I just missing the mark there? Where is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yep, I'm with you. There we go. Yep. So we can go into our outlooks. Now that, both this and the other page, go into the subscribe button, just pop your email in. And that will allow you to, you can actually choose what products you want to get sent through. So you can choose, there's a whole different range of information you can set in there. Then you can choose to get the Enzo wrap up or the climate outlooks. If you're interested in streamflow forecasts. So you actually, you can subscribe to a whole range of stuff that'll just come through to your email each time it gets updated. So this gets updated in the last week of every month, the season outlook. And so it tells you when the next one's due. When the next one comes through, which is actually this Thursday, it'll come through into your email box if you've subscribed, and it'll update for the next 3 month period. So we're talking about October, November, December, so the rest of the year. And we've got rainfall and temperatures in there. You can look at the, so once again, it's all a bit map enabled. You can look at the likelihood of wetter than average conditions or drier than average, the likelihood of wetter than average, or wetter than median rainfall. So it's, all this area is likely to have a wet September, October, November. Much more strongly likely up in the northern parts of the country. Southwest WA is more likely to be drier. So the likelihood of wetter conditions is lower, which means it's likely to be drier. You look on each month, so September, October. You can click on a location. So we'll go down to this part of the world. Oops, what did I do there? And it'll bring up a box which is tells you the so it's got your median rainfall, likelihood of exceeding the median. If we go to the chance of at least, you can see what's my chance of getting various amounts of rainfall. So how likely is it will I get 200 millimetres over the next 3 months?
How are you?
Okay, let's decrease it a little bit. 100 millimetres. All right. So, yeah. So there, you know, over the next few months, there's a reasonable likelihood of getting another 100 millimetres. And you can see the influence of that on the from the ranges. And so it brings up the bars there. Give you the likelihood. So there's different ways of looking at the outlook information. You've got the temperatures in there as well. So the temperatures. So once again, the likelihood of exceeding the median temperature. So it gives you your averages and that sort of thing in there. So there's different ways of looking at that. You can look at the accuracy of the outlook. So how accurate has the product been at this time of year? And it does vary for different locations. Stronger the green, the more accurate. So you want to keep that in mind as well. So that's what these maps are here of. So if you've got an outlook that's maybe saying it's going to be wetter or drier, but the accuracy is pretty low, you just want to take that with a little bit more of a grain of salt than you might if it was strongly green like it is here.
So crystal ball grows and phasing for the next year, 2017, is that possible or is it just a crystal ball?
Well,
okay,
so keep an eye out on the next outlook because that's going to come out on Thursday. This we actually did see a bit of a temporary weakening in the Indian Ocean Dipole through August, and this outlook doesn't look so wet or cool because of that weakening. The next outlook, I'll tell you now, is going to be very wet. It's got a very, and particularly if you look at the monthly outlooks, October particularly is very likely to be wet. It's likely to be wetter in November, and then I think it weakens a bit in as you go towards December as well. But yeah, it's
2017.
So this only goes out 3 months ahead.
Right.
So you can look at this for your, you've got your week ahead, you look at your 3 months ahead, and then you're really down to what are the broad scale climate influences that are around and what does that mean? And when you're looking further ahead than 3 months. So you know, last year there was an El Nino event around, so we could say, okay, there's it's likely that summer was going to start off pretty hot and dry. Might get a little bit wetter towards the end of summer and early autumn because of the El Nino influence. This year we've got the Indian Ocean dipole will die out during November, and that's no longer a player. And then it's just back to the question of, is there going to be a neutral or La Nina around? And if it does go into La Nina, that pushes things towards the cooler and wetter side of things. And if it stays neutral, then there's really, you know, there's not a lot we could say further ahead than 3 months. We just have to wait till the outlooks comes through. So running the model, we do have early model runs that go out through to summer, and they are pointing a little bit slightly in the wetter side of things. What indications we do have available are pointing a little bit in towards the wetter direction. Slightly more likely to be wetter for summer. That's a European model. It's got a pretty, it's all pretty neutral-ish, a little bit wet across the northern Australia. So at least it's not pointing to hot and dry at this stage. Soil moisture levels are pretty high. I think that means we won't see a lot of heat wave activity until things dry out. So probably last year we had some pretty significant heat early in summer. I don't think we'll see that this year. I think we're probably going to be waiting until probably February, March before we see some significant heat. There's a lot of moisture around, so bushfires probably likely to be at average, probably even a bit later before it gets going properly for bushfires. But once it gets going, there's a fair bit of vegetation around. You'd want to keep an eye out for the end of the season. We do have a heatwave warning service, which you can look at on our, if you go to the national page, so you go up to the Australia. And it's the forecast heat waves, so that will become active in the next month or so and run through the summer. And it produces maps of the forecast heat wave over the week ahead and the intensity of it. So I'll just very quickly, with 5 minutes, whiz through some longer term trends and changes stuff. This is a graph of carbon dioxide levels that's been put together from ice cores and more recent observations. Key thing with climate change is that we've put a really big pulse of carbon dioxide, methane and other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere in what is geologically a very short space of time. So over the last sort of 200-300 years, we've put a big spike, we've created this big spike of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that, compared to what was around geologically, is very significant. It's worth keeping in mind why there's a lot of focus on carbon dioxide is it stays in the atmosphere a long time. There's a couple of processes that pull the extra stuff back out of the atmosphere. One of those is the oceans taking up extra carbon dioxide, but that is relatively limited. And then we're talking about geological timescale stuff with your formation of carbon dioxide falling out in raindrops and turning into limestone and going into the deep oceans and things like that, which takes thousands and thousands of years. So it's a bit sobering to think that, you know, the carbon dioxide coming out of the tailpipe of your car or the power station today, about 50% of that will still be around in the atmosphere in sort of 200-year time frame. And about 20-25% of it will be there in 1,000 years time frame. So what we're doing has long-term implications. You can see this does vary a little bit in and out of ice ages. So these lower periods of lower carbon dioxide levels are ice ages. And it's a slightly complicated picture in that the ice ages happen because of the changes in the Earth's cycle. The Earth moves a little bit further away from the sun. The Earth orbit becomes a bit more elliptical. That reduces the sunshine coming in on the earth, and that allows ice to form. That then starts to, so you get this initial cooling, and then that starts that, the ice formation starts to pull carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, you get less so that, yeah, that starts to reduce carbon dioxide levels. Reducing carbon dioxide levels and methane levels reduces the greenhouse effect, so that creates even more cooling. So you run into this ice age period which feeds back on itself. The thing what we're doing now, and then coming out of the ice age, is you see the opposite thing. You see the sun moves a bit closer to the earth, or becomes a bit less elliptical. We get more sunshine on the ice on the northern parts of the on towards the poles, and that melts the ice. That releases a bit more carbon dioxide, and that causes trapping more heat. So you starts feeding back on each other, and you start melting more ice, and feeds back, and you get this warmer period, and higher carbon dioxide levels. But what we're doing is we're digging up fossil fuels, which were laid down over millions of years, pulling that back up, and putting that into the atmosphere, and causing this big spike, and there's a whole lot of calculations about what sort of impacts that would have, that, you know, increasing the greenhouse gas levels enhances the greenhouse effect, traps more heat in the atmosphere, stops that escaping to space. Now, to cut to the chase with it, that you can actually look at changes in satellite data over the last few decades, and the satellites are showing less heat, less infrared energy escaping to space in the wavelengths at which the greenhouse gases operate, so it all fits with all the theoretical calculations, the modelling. And if you look at a separate set of measurements, surface instruments, these pyranometers sitting on the surface, measurements that have been taken over the last few decades, there's more infrared heat energy coming back from the atmosphere down to the Earth's surface. So you've got two different sets of measurements that are telling us that we are enhancing the greenhouse effect from the increasing levels of greenhouse gases that we've been putting into the atmosphere. So I can send you links to papers from these if you want to look at the details. But this is, you know, this is just cutting to the chase with it. These people who argue that the greenhouse effect is not happening, or humans can't influence the climate, we are in fact having significant impacts on the climate system. There is decadal variability, so there's all sorts of interesting things that go on the oceans. You get, there's a big global conveyor system that moves heat around the oceans, that operates over decades, that causes changes in the Pacific Ocean and things like that. So there's decadal variability in there. We've got things like volcanoes that erupt and cool things down a bit for a year or two with all the particles. There are variations in the solar activity, but all of that stuff, we've also got this enhancement of the greenhouse effect going on as well, which is really starting to dominate what's going on. So we're seeing warming in Australia, clear warming trends in the oceans and the atmosphere and the land temperatures. The graph on the right is land temperature measurements and ocean temperature measurements in the green. Globally, 2014 was the hottest year on record. 2015 smashed that out of the ballpark. And this year so far, we're smashing 2015 out of the ballpark. So we're just heading into new territory. We're averaging just over 1 degree warmer than the long-term average so far this year. A little bit of that is an El Niño signal. So El Niño years do tend to be a little bit warmer. But you take the El Niño signal out, we're just very much going upwards at a very strong rate. So sea level rise, warming around the globe increases the amount of heat in the oceans, so they expand upwards. That contributes about one third of the sea level rise that we're seeing. Melting glaciers, most of the world's glaciers are melting, running near the sea, and that contributes another third. Ice sheets in Antarctica, Greenland are starting to melt and contributing another third to sea level rise. We're seeing rates in excess of 3 millimetres per year over the last 20 years globally, and that's being reflected with those sorts of rates locally, possibly even a little bit more. We're seeing 4 to 5 millimetres along the southern coast over the last 20 years. And the pointy edge of that is storm surge events like we saw in early May. I don't know how that impacted you guys down here, but we did see record sea level from the Victor Harbour tide gauge, and a lot of tide gauges out of that early May event. That's a picture of Brighton Jetty, and look out from Brighton Jetty. The projections for these are projections for future sea level rise under different scenarios. So it does matter what whether we reduce emissions quite a bit or whether we keep pumping it out. So we've got a low emissions, we've got the observations here from Port Adelaide. In the black lines, we've got the modelling that captures that, and then we've got the projections out, looking out over coming decades. And, you know, getting up to around the metre mark under the high emissions sort of side of things, that would mean that this sort of thing starts happening about once a week or more frequently. And you get bigger events and this start happening quite a bit more pretty frequently as well. Rainfall, so temperature trends are really clear. Sea level rise is a real issue. Changes in weather patterns are a little bit interesting. There's a couple of things going on. The Hadley cell there in subtropical ridge that you mentioned earlier, someone mentioned earlier, as you warm up the surface, the atmospheric circulation, this Hadley cell circulation rises, increases in height, and in response to that increases in width as well. So in simple terms, the tropics expand towards the poles. So this Hadley cell widens as the planet warms up. And that's already being observed to be happening at about 0.5 to 1 degree of latitude per decade over the last 30 years or so. So these cold fronts, this subtropical ridge is contracting further south, so we're getting more positive southern annular mode values. And that keeps the cold frontal systems further south, and it's reducing rainfall in April to October. So that's a map of the changes in rainfall. And so southern Australia is being hit pretty hard in terms of rainfall declines in April to October. And there's also concern about the impacts. What the researchers are saying is that under climate change, El Nino and La Nina events will become more intense. We're starting to see some indications of that when there's a La Nina, you're more likely to get intense rainfall and flooding, and when there's an El Nino, it's more likely to be hotter and drier. So just more extreme. Overall, average summer rainfall is probably not going to change much, but it is going to get more extreme either way. So it makes it a little bit more tricky to keep, you know, sort of, in particularly El Nino years and positive IOD years, to sort of keep create more issues with that sort of feed gap over sort of late summer in those sorts of hot and dry conditions. I looked at the Port Elliot annual rainfall. There's a really good record back there, back to 1860s. They haven't missed a month in there, which is brilliant. So if anyone knows who's taking that, buy them a beer for me. Annual rainfall, you actually don't see a lot going on there. It does vary quite a bit. The November-March rainfall has been interesting. There was a bit of a spike in there through the 40s. It's a bit hard to explain what was going on with that. But in general, there's quite a bit of variability in there. There's probably a little bit more variability in the last 30 years than there was a bit earlier, to some degree. But it is relatively stable. The April to October rainfall, it's not as strong. There's not a super strong signal in there. It was a little bit surprising. It's declined a little bit. I sort of compare it to places like Narracourt in the southeast. So that's a rainfall, similar rainfall record back to the 1860s. Annually, it's gotten drier. It doesn't look so bad, but you look at their April to October rainfall. I thought I had that in there, but it's dropped by 30% in April to October rainfall down the southeast. So Keith, Narracourt, across the border into Western Victoria. We're seeing really strong declines in April to October rainfall. So that's a signal to keep an eye on in terms of the impact of climate change.
Last year, Narracourt had 3.2
mils in October. Yeah. I think their total April to October rainfall was, I think it was something in the order of 180 millimetres, something like that. They might have cracked 200 or that maybe, but when they typically, they used to get quite reliably down there, they used to get, I think around sort of 400 millimetres April to October rainfall quite reliably. So, this is the trends that we've been seeing and this is the projections. There's a body of work on this Climate Change in Australia website if you want to go and look at this in more detail. That's the very latest body of work that was released about a year and a half ago that details climate change observations and trends and projections for climate change for various locations around Australia.
You know all that, and you haven't spoken much about wind.
with climate change?
So the general thing with the wind patterns is that there's more positive southern NMO value, so the cold front's contracting further south, stronger high pressure systems, and what that means is it's actually countering the change in frost. Frost numbers of frost actually staying much the same in some areas because of the stronger high pressure systems. And the winds are generally actually, it's actually expected to get just a little bit less windy overall. And we're seeing some indications of more intense rainfall in the northern parts of Australia and in the tropics. That'll probably take a little while to get down here. But we're starting to see some hints of more intense rainfall. And the winds, generally overall, it'll get slightly less windy. More strong high pressure systems, more clearer nights through winter, particularly through winter, lighter winds, that sort of thing. So frost risk staying much the same despite the background temperatures going up, at least in the short term. So yeah, it's some.
But then you look at that binary Friday, it was nearly an unusual wind in that.
It's pretty usual to get those sorts of northerly wind patterns. It was actually interesting because the season last year was interesting because the those northerly winds tend to happen when the subtropical ridge is sitting sort of along the southern coast of Australia, and so you get a cold front come up, and then the winds will go quite strong northerly ahead of that cold front. With the high pressure system sitting further south in summer, what we're actually seeing is a milder or less windy peak of summer. We saw that last year because the high pressure system was sitting so far south, the cold fronts weren't getting up and weren't getting the northerlies ahead of the cold frontal systems. So there's some interesting detail in there, the sort of shift in that spring warming is happening quite strongly, and so we're seeing a shift in the start of the fire seasons are starting earlier. But they actually might get a little bit less intense through the peak of the fire season with less northerly winds. So yeah, some interesting detail in there. So yeah, you guys have been great. I've probably gone a little bit over time, and we've got a cup of tea and hopefully something nice to nibble on waiting for us. So I thank Mark for inviting me down. You guys have been terrific. And the presentation, I'll make sure available as a PDF. And you've also got the recording as well. So, thank you.